Jessica Lynn Garino was a 21-year-old from Goldsboro, North Carolina. She had two sisters and had been the manager of a Wendy's. Around January 22, 2012, Jessica's roommate, a man she had known for a few years, said she took off with her dog and clothes for no reason. He said he had no idea where Jessica went. She was never seen again. I'm Ed Denzel, and this is Unfound. I've never been a homeowner, so I'll ask all of you out there, what are some of the worst things that can happen after you buy a house? I'm guessing among many different answers is that somebody moves in next to you who you can't stand. The guy who won't cut his grass. The woman who tattletales on you that you're breaking some HOA law that really no one cares about. The couple who moves in with teenagers, then when the parents are gone, the kids have rip-roaring parties with cars parked in the yard, drunk adolescents jumping off the roof into the pool, and blasting Nickelback. Really, some of these people can ruin a beautiful situation. And I should say, having been a renter all my life, it's kind of the same thing. Having good people who live above you or below you or beside you can make all the difference in whether you like an apartment or not. The problem is none of us get to choose these people. You either have good luck or bad luck. And over the course of living in a house for, say, 40 years, your luck may change several times. Well, in the case of Jessica Garino, everyone thought she had a decent guy living next door to her in Tennessee. Then everything changed after a trip to New York City. And somehow they ended up meeting again a year later in North Carolina, secretly becoming roommates. Then Jessica was gone. And like a bad neighbor, this guy was there. And now a summary of the case. This is brought to you by my friend Megan Good's website, charleyproject.org. Jessica Garino dropped out of high school in Tennessee only a few months from graduation. But Jessica had a plan. She got a job at Wendy's, and before anyone knew it, she was the store's manager at 19 years old. Jessica bought her own car and got her own place. Then Jessica went on a trip to New York City with her neighbor, Carson Cameron, a much older man who seemed harmless. Yet when Jessica returned from the trip, she was different. She stopped going to work and lost her car. One of her sisters, Ashley, discovered Carson shot up Jessica with heroin while on that trip. Soon after, Carson left the area due to the police looking for him. Then sometime later, Jessica moved to North Carolina with a friend, hoping a change of scenery would do her good. Yet not long before Jessica disappeared, Ashley discovered Jessica lied and had moved to North Carolina to live with Carson. So on January 21st, 2012, Jessica and Ashley talked on the phone. Jessica seemed fine. She said she was about to go out to eat with friends in Goldsboro. To be clear, although Ashley knew about Jessica living with Carson, Ashley never brought it up so as to avoid any arguments. Days passed after that conversation between the two, and no one heard from Jessica. A welfare check was done approximately a week later. Carson told police that Jessica took off by herself, taking her clothes and dog sometime around that January 22nd. He didn't know where Jessica planned to go, maybe back to Tennessee. She was never seen again. A month later, Carson told essentially the same story to Jessica's family when they showed up in North Carolina. Two other roommates living there echoed the same version of events. Jessica's disappearance seems to be one more of a very common pattern we've seen on Unfound over the last almost 4 years. Man says she just up and left. Yet with Jessica's and most of these types of cases, there are unanswered questions that make each unique. For Jessica's, these are, number one, she had other friends in North Carolina. Why did none of them try contacting her family when she disappeared? Number two, Jessica had a dog. What happened to it? And number three, why did the other roommate's stories change between February 2012 when they were questioned by the family and later that year when law enforcement spoke to them? Jessica's family hopes she is alive, although they realize the chances are slim. The guest for this episode is Jessica's sister, Ashley Hartman. Unfound News. I'm very sorry to announce that another Unfound guest has passed away. Janice Norwood, mother of Kimberly Norwood, died on June 27th, 2020. Her husband, Kim's father, died within the past year as well. I want the Norwood family to know that everyone at Unfound, myself, my assistants, and the audience, is thinking of them during these tough times. This brings the total to 3 for guests who are no longer with us. The other 2 are Jessica Curtis and Donna Jean Kapp. Next, the 3rd Unfound on the Ground for premium Patreon members will be coming this Monday, July 13th at 8:15 p.m. Eastern Time. The topic, how to find sources for disappearances. The discussion will be led by the guy who has done the other 2 on-the-ground segments so far, Dr. Eric Grabowski. In addition, the 2nd episode of On the Ground from June should now be playing for free on YouTube. Finally, I hope all of you had a great 4th of July, whether you are an American or not. Me, I was writing the Unfound blog for all of you Patreon supporters while the fireworks were going off on Saturday night. True story. Where you can find Unfound. Unfound supports accounts on Podomatic, iTunes, Stitcher, Instagram, Twitter, Spotify, Deezer, and Facebook. On Wednesday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern, please join us on the Unfound Podcast Channel on YouTube for the Unfound Live Show. All of you can talk with me and I can answer your questions. Contribute to Unfound at patreon.com/unfoundpodcast. This week, I need to thank Jessica. You can also contribute at PayPal, paypal.me/unfoundpodcast. I'm so happy to have on this episode of Unfound the sister of Jessica Garino, Ashley Hartman. Ashley, welcome to Unfound.
Hi.
Okay. Welcome to Unfound, Ashley. How is it where you are today?
Not bad. Sunny. Nice. Pretty.
Okay. All right. Yep. Let's start the discussion here. You are Jessica's sister. First of all, how many siblings do you and Jessica have?
There are 3 of us.
Okay.
There's... I'm the oldest, then we have a sister, Christina, who's the middle, and Jessica's the youngest.
Oh, all 3 girls then.
Yes.
Okay. What are the, I would never ask you your age, Ashley, but what were the age differences between you 3?
Almost 4 years between me and Christina, and almost 5 years between me and Jessica, and 13 months between Christina and Jessica.
Wow. So you were about 5 years older than Jessica. You are?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Would you say that how did you 3 get along? Well, not so well? Were maybe 2 of you more closer than the others? How would you explain it?
We all got along pretty good. Jessica got along with both of us better than me and Christina got along together. But, of course, because Christina and Jessica were closer in age, they were... they were close as kids, I guess. And then as we got older, that's when me and Jessica became closer.
Okay. All right. So you're the oldest, and she's the youngest. And how old, do you remember Jessica? What was she into, her interests, her education, hobbies, things like that? What can you tell the listeners about her?
She's an excellent artist. She can draw anything, mostly freehand. She's really good at it. She's got a great personality. Mm-hmm. Loves a good joke. So.
Yeah. Right. And in education, she graduated high school. Did she take any higher education after that, or what did she do? Or what was she into in high school? Athletics or what?
She didn't really do much as far as sports or any extra academic things in high school. She actually dropped out of high school her senior year.
Oh, my.
Okay. Which was kind of disappointing because she was the only one out of the three of us that didn't graduate.
Uh-huh.
So we were a little bit mad about it, and she made it all the way to senior year, but she ended up moving out, and I think that's why she dropped out of school.
Mm-hmm. What was the situation, if you can say? What situation did she get into where she moved out and dropped out? What happened there?
Honestly, I think it's because she turned 18, because her birthday was in February, so she turned 18 in February. Mm-hmm. She graduated that May. I think it was just she wanted the freedom of, hey, I don't want to be with my parents. I want to go here and live with my friends. So she did. She moved in with a couple friends, and she did really good about going to school for the first little bit of her moving out. But then after that, there wasn't really anybody there to make sure she was getting to school.
Right.
So then she just kind of quit going.
Huh. Would you say, as her older sister and the oldest sister, was that a surprise to you that she did that, being that you and your other sister did graduate? Was it a surprise?
Not that she... It was a surprise that she didn't graduate.
Mm-hmm.
But not that she moved out, because all of us kind of moved out our senior years in high school. So that was not a surprise. We all kind of, our parents were strict. So we were all like, oh, we're 18 now, we'll all move out. But we were surprised that, because Jessica was so smart and she was the best in school. Her grades were great. Mm-hmm. And she was one of those girls that she didn't have to study. You know, she didn't even have to pay attention. She just passed all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of shocking that here she was just months from graduating and she didn't.
Okay. Yeah, especially being that close. Wow.
Yeah.
Just had to hold out for a few more months. I mean, I myself did not like school that much, but I my parents would have shot me had I dropped out, and I ended up going to college too, but I was not much of a school person and don't like all the structure. But so yeah, a few months from graduating and she dropped out. Who did she live with? Where did she go?
She moved to a little town right next door to our town, and she, surprisingly, she moved in with our other sister and a couple of roommates that she had.
Mm-hmm.
So, I guess, you know, none of those people went to school. Jessica was the only school-aged kid that lived there. So, mm-hmm. I guess that's
okay.
What happened. You know, they were off doing whatever they do, and she wanted to be a part of that. So,
mm-hmm.
She did.
Yeah. Did you, as the older sister, if she would have been 18 at the time, I guess you would have been like 23, maybe you had your own things going on then, but did you try to talk to her about maybe going back to school, or was that a waste of time?
We talked about it. She was not interested, and then we'd even talked about maybe her just going to get her GED, but she never did enroll in the classes to do that. So she just started working.
Okay.
And got herself a job and was doing that instead. And you know, she seemed like she had it together outside of not going
right.
to school, but
okay.
You know, she was working and doing something. So,
well, that's good. What work did she get?
She started out as a crew member at Wendy's, and then she didn't work there very long before they made her a manager out there. So then she managed the store on a second shift.
Mm-hmm.
And so she did that for a really long time. She really liked it. She did that for a couple years, I guess. And she really did like that. And then after that, she was able to get her own place, and she was living on her own. She moved out of Christina's house.
Okay. Well, that wasn't so bad then, maybe. Because we do, of course, hear about people who drop out of school and then don't end up doing anything, you know, just lying around at home. I'm glad to hear that she did that. And being the manager of a fast food place is not easy. So, I was a manager for 7-Eleven like 20 some years ago, and it was the worst job I ever had. So I know all about that. Any men in her life, teenage years, 17, 18, 19, did she do a lot of dating, steady boyfriend, anything like that?
She had a couple little boyfriends, one that she had, I guess I left that part out, in between her getting her own place and living with Christina, right after she moved out from Christina's, was dating this other little boy that she had met while she lived at Christina's, and she ended up moving in with him and his parents for a little while, and then after that, she, I guess they broke up, and that's when she got her own place. But other than that, he was a steady boyfriend. After that, there wasn't really too many
steady
boyfriends, I guess. A couple boys that she'd go out with sometimes or have over, but
that was about it.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think maybe I should remind the audience at this time, we have to remember she was only 21 when she disappeared. So, you know, there's not a lot of her adult life maybe to talk about here. We're just mainly talking about her teenage years. But, all right, so she drops out. She gets a job. Ends up living on her own. Being her older sister, were you worried about her? Let's just say when she was 19, 20, worried about her, anything? You know, once again, things that come up on this program, domestic violence, any violence from these guys that she knew, any drug issues, any crime, anything that you could talk about maybe that you were worried about back at this time?
At that time, no. The guy that she was dating, he was a really nice guy. Had a couple medical issues himself. Nothing real serious. But no, I mean, he worked. He was a security guard somewhere. I don't really remember. His parents were really country people, you know, all about doing little arts and crafts and growing their gardens. And, you know, they were both retired. But no, I mean, she seemed to be okay. And there wasn't anybody that was around that I was too worried about. She was buying herself a car at that time because she'd never had a car up until then. So when she started working at Wendy's, she was able to buy a car. That was nice.
Right. She does sound to me fairly self-sufficient, Ashley.
Yeah. Yeah, she was doing really good.
Okay. All right, so as the oldest sister of the three, looking at your youngest sister, it doesn't sound to me like you had too many concerns, which, you know, you hear about a girl dropping out of high school and, you know, you start to get a little leery about the track that they're on, but it seems like she had an idea of what she wanted to do, and that was that. And these were not bad ideas. Okay, let's just talk. We're going to just talk about him in general and what you and your other sisters knew about him. And, of course, he's going to dominate the conversation later. But what can you tell the listeners about Carson Cameron? Who is he?
He was a neighbor of hers. The place that she had gotten while she worked at Wendy's, she had gotten it, and after she got it, she decided maybe that we should live together, which I thought was a great idea too. But we had went over there one day to just clean up, you know, clean up the house. Nobody had moved in yet. And this guy comes over. He's an older man, you know, probably a little bit older than our parents. Introduced himself. He was a super nice guy. Said if we needed anything, you know, mops or brooms, cleaning supplies, he had everything, you know. So just to let him know if we needed anything. And actually, he was the only neighbor we had. There was only two houses back there. So one was his and one was ours. So, you know, he seemed really nice, real friendly, even cooked us food the night that we were there cleaning, just so, you know, he said he didn't want us hungry. So, yeah, he seemed pretty nice. Just an older man. He lived alone, had a dog, mm-hmm. said he worked out of town, you know.
Okay.
And that was pretty much that.
Okay, so was Jessica renting this house or something?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
And so it was like what you might call a coincidence that she ended up living right next to Carson.
And actually, they both had the same landlord. He owned both the homes there.
Okay. Okay. How much older would you say Carson was than the both of you? You, of course, were about 5 years difference, but you are almost in your mid-20s. Maybe she's 20. How old would you say that Carson was, let's just say in 2011? How old do you think he was?
50s.
Wow.
50, 51, yeah.
Okay.
And Jessica would have been, you know, 19, 20.
Right.
Somewhere around there.
Okay. So did you two live together? And can you even remember, I know this is going back probably almost 10 years, but do you remember, like, the month that you moved in with Jessica, and do you remember what year it was, possibly?
It would have been 2010. I want to say maybe April or May of 2010.
Okay, so over 10 years ago now. Okay. While you two were living with him, did he have any roommates? Did you, all of you, ever get together to, like, hang out, watch a football game, or, you know, how well did you get to know him?
He lived alone. He had a friend that would stop by every now and then, which happened to be a guy that I had went to school with. We'd get together and grill out. Sometimes, you know, we'd go down. We have a huge river that runs through here. So sometimes we'd all get together, and I have two little kids, so we'd all go down by the river and let the kids swim, and, you know, everybody would just kind of hang out down there and when it was warm and nice out. But, yeah, I mean, so I guess we got to know him. I mean, we were the only neighbors we had, and
right.
He was gone a lot of the time, but when he was in town, he was all about, hey, let's make some food. Hey, let's drink a beer. You know, I guess he didn't really have a whole lot of friends. He had the one friend that would come by regularly.
Okay.
So.
All right. Did he give you two any creepy vibes?
Not at first.
Mm-hmm.
But after so much of, hey, let's hang out, and not really creepy, it was just kind of weird, you know, and I thought maybe he just doesn't have any family or anybody, so he's kind of reaching out, which still was a little bit weird because he's so much older,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, then sometimes old people are alone, so.
Right. Okay. When he said he would be out of town, did he ever give you an exact idea about what he was doing for work when he was out of town? What kind of job did you think that he had?
He made it sound like he did construction. And the guy that he would have come over would sometimes go out of town with him too. But they would claim to be millwright workers.
Okay.
So they would do stuff like that. Now, where they would go, not really sure. that wasn't, and we never knew for how long anybody, he would ask us to keep an eye on his dog because he did not take his dog with him.
Mm-hmm.
So we would keep an eye on the dog while he was gone, but we never knew, he would tell us when he was going to leave, but he wouldn't tell us when he was coming back. So we never really knew that.
Okay. Have to ask this, anything that you ever believed could have been going on, romantically, intimately, personally between Jessica and Carson?
Not to my knowledge, and it didn't appear that way. At that time, she was still hanging out with guys her age, people mm-hmm. she went to school with, showing interest in other people, not him, mm-hmm. not that way.
Yeah. Did you ever get the feeling maybe that Carson would have liked a little bit more attention from her or you, even though there was like 30 age years in difference?
Kind of with her, but he never did come out and say anything like that. He was just kind of almost like he was trying to just put her under his wing. Like, I'm going to take care of you. And here's why, because it started out like this. Where we lived, we shared a water line. And so both of our water bills came on one bill. And when we first moved in, he said, I'll just let you know how much the difference is from the bill, because nobody had lived there before. And then all of a sudden he's like, oh, I'll just pay it. You know, oh, well, you know, Jess isn't going to have her half. I'll pay it. Then he started paying her half of the rent, and, you know, it just, that was a little bit weird, but
mm-hmm.
like, oh, okay.
If you can say, what kind of conversations did you and Jessica have about this when this was like, this was going on? If you can say.
Well, I asked her about it,
mm-hmm.
and she... Obviously, at 19, 20 years old, that was the greatest thing because she didn't have to spend any of her money on bills.
Right.
So she got to just spend her money because she liked to buy clothes and, you know, stuff for her car, CDs,
mm-hmm.
Stuff like that. But so that was okay. She basically, as long as he was willing to do it, she was going to let him do it. So I said, oh, okay, you know, you don't find this weird. She's like, no, he's just my friend. Okay.
Okay. And you were you working at the time? Did you say that you, we've not talked about this, the listeners should know. I don't think I've ever asked you. Do you have children, or did you have children at the time, or did you?
I did at that time.
Oh, you did. And your children were living in this house with you and Jessica as well?
Yes.
Okay. How did you think that your children got along with Carson? Did he treat them okay?
He always had popsicles for them all the time. I mean, they were little then. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah, I mean, he was really nice to them. Always had popsicles in the freezer. They'd go to the grocery store and come back and say, oh, I got something for the boys. So, I mean, they liked that. But as far as, you know, just going over his house and hanging out, no, they didn't really – do that. And
okay.
They didn't really get to know him like that. He was just the neighbor that always had popsicles
okay.
to them.
Okay.
Didn't mean much.
All right. The neighbor who always had popsicles. Okay. Now, it seems, though, that even though you were getting along with him, maybe he was starting to creep you out maybe just a little bit, maybe a little being maybe we might call needy, always wanting to get together and things. But something did eventually happen, and it was an overdose at his place. When did this happen? How did you find out about it? Please explain that to the listeners.
Well, I worked at a factory at the time, and I got off at 2:30 in the afternoon. And so I had pulled in. Jessica, I'm trying to think. I think she was over at Carson's house at the time, which... You know, nothing seemed out of the way. I mean, there was no company over at either house or anything like that. Carson and his friend had come by the night before, but everybody was already in bed. So we're just like, oh, you know, we're going to bed. And they're like, oh, okay. And they went back to Carson's house. But the next day, when I pulled in, Carson came walking over and met me at the car and said that his friend had died. And I said, oh my gosh, you know, what happened? And he said that they do believe he may have overdosed in his spare bedroom. Mm. And I guess the EMTs had just left with him or coroner. You know, I don't know who was there. I was not there. But that was in, I want to say, could have been eight. Oh, it might have been later than that. I don't know for sure. Just one second. I'm trying to think of when it was.
Let's just say, may I just ask you this way? Was it in 2011?
It was 2010, June of 2010.
June of 2010. Okay.
Yep.
All right. So you come home, you find this out. So are you saying by the time you got home, the EMTs had already been there and taken this guy away?
Yes.
Okay.
He actually asked me if I could go over there and clean up the bedroom that the guy had passed away in because he said he could not do it. So he asked me if I would go do it. And so I just said, okay.
Okay.
You know, there wasn't much to the scene. It's not like it was a bloody mess or anything like that. But, you know, yeah, okay. So him and Jessica just kind of hung out the rest of the day talking, I assumed he was upset because his friend had just passed away. We did later find out that the guy had overdosed.
Mm-hmm.
So.
All right. How did you find out that he overdosed?
I was actually friends with his family, with his sisters and his mother and father.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, they had told us that, you know, he had in fact overdosed on morphine.
Wow.
So,
that's not a very common way to go these days, I don't think. But, you know, when you think overdose, you maybe think opioids or heroin or something like that, not exactly morphine. Okay. And how did things go after that? I mean, did he get another roommate? Did he seem to be devastated by this roommate? Did it take him a while to recover from it? Did you ever get the idea that Carson might have been doing morphine or other things in his house too?
I did think that he was upset about his friend passing away. I mean, that was pretty obvious.
Mm-hmm.
He still carried on with his life the way that he normally did. Really, the only thing that changed is he had made a really strange comment about if somebody ever overdosed in his house again, nobody would ever know about it. And we found that very weird because why would it happen twice? You know,
right.
I mean,
well, yeah.
It was just really, it was a really, really strange thing to say, especially after your friend just passed away. So to us, we were just kind of like, whoa, that's really weird. I mean, that would not be, I don't know that I would think that if that ever happened to me, but I don't know. So that was really strange. And also, he started talking to my sister, Jessica, about going out of town with him, little vacations, and I thought he worked out of town, but then he started asking her if she wanted to go.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a little bit weird too, you know, because if you're going out of town for work, clearly she can't go with you for that.
Did Jessica think it was weird?
No, she thought it would be a really cool idea. His first proposal to her was New York. She had never been. And, of course, everybody's fascinated by New York.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the first place that he had brought up to her, that he would love to take her there, thinks that she would love the city. They could do all kinds of shopping. There's everywhere in the world to shop in New York City. So she agreed to go with him.
Yeah. And did they go?
They did. He had given her a little bit of time to prepare. They planned the trip. I can't remember exactly when they went.
Mm-hmm.
but he had given her his credit cards and told her to go buy all new things to go on this trip, all new clothes, even took her to have her hair done before they went.
Wow.
Yeah. So he told her, you know, they're whatever you think you might need for this trip, you get. And she did. I mean, she bought all new luggage. She bought all new clothes. You know, she had her hair done. She was set for a trip. So they did go, and they were gone for a few days. She was coming back. It was going to be really late one night. They had driven there, and it was going to be really late that night. And at that time, I was working second shift. I'd switched to second shift at my job. So I was trying to stay up after work that night to greet her home. Mom had kept the kids because I figured they would get home really late. I didn't want to bombard the kids with us, you know, being excited about her getting there. So she did. She got home that night, and we pretty much just went to bed right after. The next day, we had asked how the trip went, because another friend came and stayed with us that night. She was hanging out with me while we were waiting on her to get back. And so she just stayed the night with us, too. But we had asked her, you know, how the trip was. We're excited. She had little souvenirs for everybody, you know, T-shirts and keychains and, you know, pretty typical stuff. So later on, she told me more about their trip. Of course, they'd seen things, you know, went on. She rode a subway for the first time. She thought that was really cool. So then she said that it was a really cool trip, but they didn't do as much as she wanted to do, because I guess at that point she had found out that he was up there to buy drugs. So it wasn't really a vacation. It was a business trip, I guess you could say, for him.
Yeah.
And she said that she was completely embarrassed when they left the hotel, because he had left syringes all over the room, and somebody had to come in there and clean that up. And she said it was really embarrassing to have somebody come in there to see that.
She told you that. This is the day after she got back from this trip. This Jessica told you that.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Did that be, of course, you already knew that his roommate had overdosed at some point in the past. Were you then surprised by this or not?
Yes and no. I guess we all kind of figured that he was doing some form of drug. Didn't realize to that extent. But she said that he was using heroin. So she asked me not to say anything about it, but I guess maybe later on she told him that she had told me. And so he came over to tell me about their trip and how great it was. And he whips out a phone real quick and he says, oh, well, let me show you this really funny video. And I say, oh, okay, you know. And he says, he plays this video, and it's my sister sitting on a bed in a hotel room, and she is basically a zombie. Can't hold her head up. Her eyes are closed. She's kind of rocking back and forth. I mean, I just, whoever she is not there at that time. And I guess this was her first time doing heroin. And they both, he thought it was funny. She, I guess, thought it was funny. And it was like several minutes of this video of her just being a zombie. That's the best way I could describe it. I don't really know how to describe that.
Okay.
So at that point, it's like, I don't really find that funny. And I asked Jessica, you know, what is this? I mean, you were so embarrassed that you were doing it too. And so I guess at that point, maybe it was peer pressure that she thought maybe she'd have to. So, you know, he wouldn't be mad, or I don't even really know why that happened.
She couldn't explain it?
No, just that he had asked her to do some with her or with him, and I guess she obliged, and that was how that went down.
Wow. Do you think that she had ever done drugs before?
Did I think that?
Do you think that Jessica had ever done drugs before? Yeah.
I knew she had smoked some pot. I did know that. Anything like to that extent? No, absolutely not. After that experience, yeah. That's when things really started to become an issue. So.
All right, so let me ask you this. So what you're saying is that this was her first time that she had ever done heroin. He gave it to her, I guess, through a needle. And then what you're saying is after this, she wanted to do it again?
Yeah.
Okay. How long after this trip, and maybe just to remind everybody, if you can, what month and year was this trip, do you think?
This is going to be between August or September
of 2010.
To
2010. So still, we're talking a year and some months before her disappearance. Okay?
Yes.
All right. So after they get back, Wendy, at that point when you see that video, do you start thinking maybe she's automatically going to become an addict or what? And, you know, maybe you could explain that. When you saw that, did you think, man, I hope I'm not going to start having problems with her?
I didn't think that about her. I didn't think that she would become an addict.
Mm-hmm.
I guess at first I thought our problems would be him.
Yeah.
And, you know, what's he going to try to do? What's he got over her head now? So, no, not at first did I think that. But after a little while, maybe a couple weeks, it wasn't hard to see her attitude is kind of changing, and they were spending a lot of time together at that point.
Mm-hmm.
She was going over to his house quite a bit. He was still trying to be the, hey, let's do a cookout, let's do this, and it more or less became a Carson and Jessica thing. Our other sister had come and started staying with us, too. She did not like him at all.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't want to talk to him. I mean, she wasn't rude or anything to him, but she didn't like him at all. So her and I kind of stayed at our house with the kids, and Jessica and Carson stayed over there doing whatever it was they were doing.
Did you ever... Once you started to notice this change, you said in a few weeks, let's just say it was October of 2010, did you and your other sister try to talk to her? What did she say?
We did try to talk to her. At first, she just kind of laughed at us, like, because we thought maybe she might have a problem,
mm-hmm.
that maybe it wasn't best that she was hanging out with him. She told us that basically everything that we were telling her, Carson had already told her we would say to her, that we were going to try to control her life and that we didn't have her best interest in mind, and that we were just out for ourselves. And he tried to tell her that if it wasn't for him paying her half of the bills, we wouldn't even be able to be there anyway. And just really... really weird things that she was saying to us. So eventually we kind of backed off of her just because we didn't want her to think we were trying to suffocate her or try to, as weird as it sounds, but prove to her what he is saying is true,
mm-hmm.
if that makes sense. Because, I mean, I know that what he was saying to her was not true, but she obviously did not believe that.
Right.
So we did, but then we kind of backed off and let her, you know, just do what she felt she needed to do. And as the months went by, her, like I said, her, she started to get kind of angry. And you could definitely tell the days that she didn't have something as opposed to the days that she did.
Oh. Did you, not that you had to do this, I mean, you're just an older sister, you don't want to be a pipeline, but did you tell your other, the rest of your family about this? Did your parents know that this was going on?
My parents did not. Christina knew at that time. Me and Christina didn't tell our parents.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of hard to
right.
tell your parents that.
Right, well, yeah. Okay. So let's say you get into 2011. Now, you had told me, though, that at one point Carson did end up leaving town. When did he move? Why did that happen?
He ended up leaving. I don't remember the month, but it was in 2011. He had went out of town one time, and the landlord came by his house while we were at our house, and the landlord came by his house with some police officers, and they were letting them he was letting the cops in the house, in his house.
Huh.
And they were coming out with paperwork and his computer and just really weird things. We didn't know what was going on. We didn't know where he was or when he would even be back. So they were coming out of his house with all of his things, and we didn't know what was going on. He ended up coming back out of town a couple of days after that, and meanwhile, the cops have been coming to our house every day, wondering if he had been by there, and we're like, no, he hasn't been here, and we haven't seen him. Well, he ended up coming back. But it was really weird. He didn't pull in his driveway. He pulled in our driveway. And maybe he had already been to his house, or maybe I'm not really sure. But we told him that, you know, the cops had been over there. And he went to his house, and he grabbed a laundry basket of what I assumed to be clothes. And he got in his car, and we never saw him again. He left his dog. He left everything. He only took a laundry basket. And he left.
Huh.
That was in 2011. Nope. Yeah, so shortly after that, we ended up moving.
Let me ask you this before we get into this. How did Jessica respond to that, all of that?
She didn't really have a response. You know, wonder where he is. She didn't let on like she was upset about it. Not mm-hmm. that she was happy either. It was just kind of like, oh, well, whatever. One of those kind of things. So, honestly, me and Christina were ecstatic because now he's gone.
Yeah.
And now we can help her.
Right.
So.
Okay. Do you think it's possible, looking back at it now, do you think that Jessica might have alerted him that the police were coming over there while he was out of town?
Probably. Yeah, I could see her doing that. I mean.
Okay. All right. Did the police ever, when they would come these days, did they ever say why they were looking for him? Do you have any idea what caused them to be wanting to talk to him? And of course we can suspect it's drugs, but the motive, you know, for them to be there. Please.
They didn't, the cops were going to tell us, they just asked if we did see him to let them know and to give them a call, but they never did say any reason why. We actually didn't even know until we read it in the paper that he had gotten in trouble. It was for what we had read in the paper was him and his brother were buying things from a Home Depot and changing the price stickers on them and then returning them for more money, I guess. Well, for what they're worth when you return them. So they were doing that, which made a lot of sense because he did go to Home Depot a lot. And he was always like, oh, let me just take this back and return it. Oh, I bought this. But I don't need it. I don't know why I bought it. You know, let me take this back and return it. And it was just nothing to us. But but then when we read that in the paper, we're like, oh, my gosh, that makes perfect sense. No wonder he's always going to Home Depot. But I guess they had been doing that for quite some time. And something else was done. He would sell things a lot on eBay. But what I understand, I guess he wasn't doing it the way he was supposed to, or he was mailing packages, but there was nothing in them.
Right, and saying that they got stolen on the way.
Yeah, so maybe that's why they took his computer.
Yeah, maybe I should explain to the listeners what she means by the Home Depot thing. What they would do is they would go in, just an example, find something that was $100 and then switch price tags maybe to $50. So when they would check out, the item would scan at $50 instead of $100. And then later they would bring back this item that is supposed to be $100 to return it, and then the store would give them $100, meaning they make a $50 profit. Right?
Yep.
That's how that works, correct?
Yep.
Yeah, maybe I know how to do that a little too. Maybe I know how to do that a little too well. I've never done that. Just so the listener, I've never done. I would never do something like that. Okay. So he was doing that. He was pulling this thing off on eBay, which is another very common scam. You say you have something, you're going to ship it. When it gets to the buyer, it's empty, and then there's, you know, it's fraud. And then the seller, who would be Carson in these cases, would say, well, it must have been stolen in transit. So that's a very popular scam too. Okay, so they were on to him. They were looking at his computer, took that away. They're looking for him. He leaves in 2011, never comes back to where you live. You were all living in Tennessee at the time. Now, you did say, though, at some point, you and Jessica and I guess your other sister moved out of that house.
We did. We still stayed in the town,
mm-hmm.
but we did move to a different house.
Okay.
And so we were staying there. That's because drug problems still continued. And again, like I said, I mean, you could tell the days that she has something and the days that she didn't. The days that she didn't have something, you didn't want to talk to her. And the days that she did, you couldn't talk to her.
Mm-hmm.
So,
where was she getting this? I mean, being that Carson left town, who was then getting drugs for her? I mean, how did she know where to go? Was this somebody that Carson put her onto, or what?
Honestly, I don't know where she was getting them. Jessica would spend a lot of her time, like in the warmer months, she would spend a lot of her time at the river. And honestly, she would bring to our house some of the craziest people, like complete strangers. Oh, they're going to have dinner with us, or oh, they're going to just stay here for the night, or you know, they just need to take a shower. So I mean, some of the people that she met were, you know, we didn't know them, but whoever these people were that she was getting her drugs off of is beyond me. I couldn't tell you who they were. I don't know. I thought her main person was him, but I guess you start living that lifestyle, maybe you have more than one.
Right, and it's almost like one of those things that a person who starts doing drugs automatically has the ability to find people who sell drugs. It's like a supply and demand thing. The rest of us who don't do drugs, we don't know where to do it. But people who do it, they know the questions to ask, and they, you know, can follow it to the source. Okay. All right, so even though Carson leaves, he's out of the picture, she's still doing this and having up days and down days, and we, of course, talk a lot about addictions on this program. But at some point in 2011, I mean, maybe I should ask you this. I mean, was she able to keep her job through all of this, or did she quit, or what did she do?
No, she ended up being fired, and she said it's because somebody stole some money out of the safe at work, and she left the store to follow them to get the money back. And she was fired for leaving the premises. How true this is, I don't know. I mean, that could be what happened, or that could not be what happened. You know, I felt like I should believe her. I didn't think that she would lie about that. But so that's what happened. She ended up being fired for leaving the premises while she was supposed to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Since she lost her job, she ended up losing her car also because she wasn't able to pay for it. So then at this point, she had no job and she had no car.
Wow.
We tried to get her to get another job. She wouldn't. So she just kind of ran around living like a little party girl, I guess. You know, coming and going as she pleased, hanging out with this person or that person. We did try to get her some rehabilitation. We talked to several different drug counselors, took her to a drug rehab in our community, and it's like they would take her back and talk to her one-on-one, and she would come out and say, okay, we can go, because they didn't see a problem.
Mm-hmm.
I guess she was answering the questions the way that she needed to, or, you know, there was no problem. And she would tell them, you know, I don't even have a problem. And we would try to talk to them, but it never went anywhere. We could never get her the help.
Very common. Very, very common. And you're right. Addicts can put on a good face. You know, they're very good at, you know, covering things up because that's what they do. So that's very unfortunate. Did you, being your older sister, did you ever tell her, Jessica, do you not see the big difference between the way you are now and the way you were a year ago? Cannot tell the difference? I mean, anything like that?
I did try to talk to her about it. She didn't see the difference, I guess, where it was just a gradual change. Maybe she didn't notice it the way we had. I even tried to show her pictures of herself. You know, here's what you look like before, and here's what you look like now. Because, and not that she, you know, I know a lot of times, even the way that I think about people on drugs is like skinny, you know, really skinny. Sunken in faces. She didn't look like that. You know, she was a very healthy weight. Her biggest thing is she just had the blackest circles around her eyes, and they just did not go away, ever. Mm. I mean, ever. They never went away. And I would take pictures of her and say, look at you, you know, here's you last year, and here's what you look like now. And in her mind, she was just, and this is a pretty girl, but she is just as pretty as she was last year, and it's like she didn't see that, I guess. She didn't see that change the way we saw it. And then at this point, our parents knew that she had a problem. We did end up telling them, and it was kind of hard. It was kind of hard not to hide anymore. I mean, you can't hide it for too long. So they did know. My mom tried to talk to her. My dad, he talked to her, but that's not like he's stern in the way that he talks. He's very forward, and sometimes what he has to say is maybe not the nicest way to say it.
Yeah.
So, of course, that caused animosity between the two of them because, you know, he just hates me. He just hates everything I do, blah, blah, blah. And you know, for her, she didn't see that this is just how he is. He's been that way our whole lives. But so then she just quit going around them all together. She wouldn't go to family cookouts or anything like that. Like, if we asked her, she'd just automatically be mad. You know, I don't know why you'd ask me. I'm not going.
Right.
I think the last one she went to, her and dad got into it. She walked. She left and started walking down the road. We had to go pick her up and take her home. But, so she just kind of quit socializing with her parents. for the most part.
Okay. So this goes through 2011. She has this addiction. She loses her job. She loses her car. She wants to do, as you said, be a party girl. She's meeting all these strange people, bringing them back to the house. They're probably also fellow addicts, or at least people who are helping her get her drugs. And then all of a sudden, she decides to move from Tennessee to North Carolina. Tell the listeners about that.
Well, she moved there in December, but we didn't know that she had moved between October and December. I guess it was about the beginning of October. Me and my other sister had decided to ask Jessica to move out. And she moved out and moved into a friend of hers' house. And so we just assumed, like, that's where she was living. So she had been living there. I called her in December to ask her about Christmas plans. And that's what she told me, that she had moved to North Carolina, that she wouldn't be there for Christmas.
Hmm.
And so I asked her, you know, well, when did you move? And she hadn't been gone for very long, maybe a week at that time, because it was the middle of December, so it might have been maybe a week. She said that she had moved there with another friend of ours. And I said, oh, okay, and I didn't have any reason not to believe her because I hadn't seen that other friend in a little while either. So I thought, oh, okay, well, maybe she's getting her life on track. And, you know, our other friend was from North Carolina, and, you know, that's where her parents still live. So I thought, well, they're probably staying with her parents, and, you know, that'll be really good, and yada, yada, yada.
Okay. All right, what did she say she was doing in North Carolina?
She said she was getting a job. Her and our friend's name was Rebecca. Her and Rebecca were getting jobs. And they were just gonna live there and work and, I guess, just live a grand life.
Okay.
I'm not really sure. They went there for work.
Okay. All right. So that's how you found out. So what you're saying is there was a period of time before she went to North Carolina that you two weren't living together anymore.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So she went there and you talked to her and she goes, like, yeah, I'm in North Carolina now. She's with this, and did she say Goldsboro, North Carolina? Was that your understanding?
She didn't tell me what part. The part that our friend lived in was just outside of Boone, North Carolina, and I can't even think of the name of the town that she's from. But I mean, it's literally like an hour away from us, if that long.
Okay.
Basically, right over the mountain. So we just thought, oh, okay. Well, you know, I just assumed that she'd probably come into town every now and then. I had no idea she was at Goldsboro at that point. It wasn't until later, a little bit later, that I found out she was in Goldsboro. But then I also found out she was not there with Rebecca.
Right. We'll get into that. We'll certainly get into that, of course. All right.
Okay.
So you find out she's in North Carolina. From then on, until her disappearance, which we're just going to say is January 23rd for now, how often do you talk to her? Do you text back and forth once a week, every day? How often were these communications between you and Jessica?
Me and Jessica talked every day. Either she would call me or I would call her. We text back and forth, talked on the phone. She'd usually call me after she got off work or after I got off work, whichever one got off last would call. Sometimes I worked late and sometimes I did too. But every day, some conversations were good and some were not so good. But
okay.
Still called every day.
Could you still tell those good days and bad days like you did when you were around her in person?
They didn't seem to be as bad. Like I said, sometimes when she would call me, she would be angry with me.
Mm-hmm.
And she said that she was, at that point, had started to go to a rehab. And so I thought, you know, maybe she needs to just go through this. And if she needs to be mad at me, she can be mad at me. But at least she called me. Mm-hmm. So But then, you know, the next day I would hear from her, and she was chipper and happy and, hey, you know, sorry I yelled at you yesterday. I was just having a bad day, or, you know, I was just in a bad mood, or, you know, nothing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, so it seemed like she was doing better. But, yes, she still did have good and bad days.
Okay. So you're talking to her every day, you're saying she had a job of some type, allegedly. Maybe her personality had kind of evened out a little bit more. You think that she's living with this other young woman from North Carolina. And so now tell the listeners about your last conversation with her. And I have in my notes that was January 21st, 2012. Please talk about that discussion.
Okay, well, she had called me that night. It was a Saturday, and I was up at a friend's house. She called, just like any other day, and she said, hey, I'm calling you real quick. She said, I'm going to go out to dinner with a couple of my friends from work, and I said, oh, okay. And so she said, I also wanted to let you know that I won't have any minutes on my phone tomorrow, but she said that her phone ran out of minutes tomorrow, and she wouldn't be able to get any until the next week. I said, oh, okay, you know, that's fine. And so we chatted probably about an hour or so, you know, nothing real important, just kind of chit-chat like normal. It was a good day for her. She wasn't mad. She seemed really excited to go out with her friends. So we talked, and then she said she had to go because they were going to leave. And I said, all right, well, I guess I'll just talk to you next week then. She said, okay. And we hung up the phone, and that was that for the night. I assume she went out with her friends and had some dinner. I tried to contact her the next day just to be sure, you know, if her phone really was out of time. There was no answer, so I just assumed that it was. And
you didn't... I have to ask, you didn't trust her on that?
Not that I didn't trust her. I just wanted to see. I don't know. I believe her. I don't think that she would lie about not having minutes on her phone. I just thought, well, we'll just see. Maybe it didn't really run out or something. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know why I called.
Okay. So you did try calling her. I guess that would be the next day. Would be the 22nd. And it went right to voicemail. Did it ring? What did it do?
I want to say it might have rang once or twice and then went to voicemail. So then I just assumed that it was out of time. And then when she didn't call back anymore, so I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, no big deal. She told me this was going to happen, so I didn't really worry much about it.
Okay.
Next week came, she didn't call me, so I tried to call her, but her phone was not working.
Okay.
So, well,
so when you say the next week, you maybe say like 5 days from then? From the last conversation you had with her? Maybe let's say like the 26th?
Yeah. Friday, let's see. It would have been the 22nd. When I tried to call her and wasn't able to get a hold of her.
Okay.
Which was there before? That Friday, because she said that she got paid on Friday.
Okay.
And so I just assumed she would have minutes on Friday.
All right.
So, but she didn't. So I thought, well, maybe she just hasn't put time on her phone yet. So
okay.
I didn't hear from her again, and I you know, tried to call her, but it wouldn't go through. Another week went by, and then I thought, well, I'll call her job and leave a message with her job for her to call me back,
yeah.
You know, and then she'll know that, hey, I'm trying to get a hold of her. So I called her job, and they told me that she never showed back up for work. She was supposed to come to work January 23rd and did not.
Oh.
So
what was this job?
What
was this job?
She described to me it was a company called TPI, and she said that she with a fire watch for welders. They were building an electrical plant, I think. And so that's what she did. What she told me she did.
Okay. All right, that's what she was doing. And then, but they're saying that 2 days after you talked to her, she never showed up for work.
Never showed back up for work. She was supposed to come in Monday, and she never did. And she had never come back since then.
Okay, that had to worry you.
So, it did. So I was thinking, okay, you know, where would she be? Why wouldn't she call? So I had an address for her. And by this point, I did know that she was in Goldsboro. So I did have an address for her. Unfortunately, it was like 7 or 8 hours from where I live. So I did call the police station there and ask them if they could do a welfare check at that address.
Okay.
And,
and what was that address? You can say it.
And I cannot remember the house number.
I got the number here, but just, you know, because that's what I do. I keep these notes just in case. This was the address on Old Grantham Road?
Yes.
Okay. So you told them to go check where she was living on Old Grantham Road in Goldsboro, North Carolina, and what happens?
So the officer calls me back about 45 minutes later and says that he did not get to speak with my sister, but he talked to, and this was his exact words, I talked to a Cameron fellow, and he said he didn't know where she was.
Huh.
And I said, Carson Cameron? And he said, yeah, you know him? And I said, yeah, he used to be our neighbor. And he said, well, that's so funny because he said he didn't even know Jessica had a sister. I said, well, that's really funny because he's met everybody in our family.
And that is that the point that you found out that what had really happened was Jessica had left Tennessee to go to North Carolina to live with Carson? Is that the point that you found this out?
Yes, that's the point that I was absolutely certain about it, yep.
Okay, and she had been doing this, and she hadn't told you about it, and in fact, you ended up finding out that she lied about living with this other friend, even going there with this other friend. That was a lie as well?
Yes, that had actually never happened.
And where was this woman who was supposed to be living with Jessica?
She was in North Carolina at her parents' house, but that's, like I said, she lives an hour from where I live, which would be about 6 or 7 hours from where Jessica actually was. When I had talked to that girl, I'd actually run into her, and she said that she hadn't even spoke to Jessica, so she wasn't sure where she was, and I said, well, she told me she was living with you, and she said, no, I've been at my parents, and I said, oh, okay. So I tried to bring it up to Jess, but sometimes you got to be careful with her because you don't want to trigger anything to make her mad.
All right, so hold on a second. We just need to be clear on this. So you actually found out that Jessica lied to you before she disappeared?
Yes.
But you didn't find out that
I knew that she lied about who she was with.
Right, but you didn't find out about Carson after she disappeared.
Yes.
And what you're also saying is even though you found out that Jessica lied to you about who she went to North Carolina with, you never did bring it up to her.
I tried, but it was kind of just it was left unanswered. It wasn't, and it was a go nowhere, and I didn't feel the need to pursue.
Okay.
I felt like if she wanted me to know, she'd tell me.
All right, so she was perpetrating a lie on you, but at some point by accident you found that she was lying to you. You did find out, but you never brought it up to her. You just allowed her to continue to believe that you believed her.
Yes.
Okay. But then she goes missing, and we've already gone through that. You talk to her on the phone, and then you can't reach her for several days. You have this welfare check. The police show up there, and who's there but none other than Carson Cameron. And that's when you found out the truth, the real, the total truth, that she was living with him.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, that had to stun you, especially since he lied and said, I didn't even know that Jessica had a sister, which is crazy. When the police officer was there, did Carson admit that Jessica had been living with him? You know, what was that conversation, the way you understand it?
The officer told me that, yes, Jessica had lived there, but Carson had told him that she just up and left in the middle of the night, and he didn't know where she went or who she went with. She just left and had never been back.
Huh.
So at that point, that's when I asked if I could file a missing persons report because nobody had talked to her in 2 weeks,
mm-hmm.
two maybe 3 weeks. And nobody had talked to her, not friends, not my mom, you know, because Jessica had been trying to reach out to my mother also after she had moved away, I guess trying to build a relationship. She was trying to get all of us to move out there with her to get a job out where she worked. So that made it really odd, too, that she was trying to have everybody come out there to get a job with her, and yet she wasn't even telling us everything. But so they did let me file the missing persons report, and I guess that's when the investigation opened and started.
Okay. Did you tell this officer that there were police officers, at least law enforcement of some degree, in Tennessee looking for Carson Cameron? Did that come up?
I did not. I did not actually tell them at all, and only because it had been so long, I didn't know what had happened, if he'd gotten in trouble for whatever he had done. Honestly, I don't think it ever even crossed my mind at that point.
All right. Just wondering. That's just a question. That's fine. It's not your job to be a law enforcement and let them know about those things. I'm just wondering if it came up. Just wondering. Okay. So let's go to this. Now, at some point, you took it upon yourself to go to North Carolina. Can you tell, being that, of course, Jessica is still missing, of course, she's still missing to this day. We're doing this interview on July 2nd, 2020. You took it upon yourself to go to Goldsboro, North Carolina. Who did you go with, and what happened when you went there?
I went with a friend of mine and an ex-boyfriend of Jessica's, the same boyfriend that Jessica had lived with him and his parents. He went with me. We went there. We had printed out flyers before we went so that we could post them around the town that, you know, around Goldsboro, ask people in and around the area if they had seen her, recognized her, know her. Anything like that. Her birthday was that weekend, so we thought if she is out and about, this would be an ideal time because she'll want to be out for her birthday. We had even, because her birthday was on Saturday that year, we had went to this nightclub that she had told me about. It was called Halo's, and it was like a bar and grill type thing. It was like a restaurant at day and then a bar at night. So we had went there, you know, at dinner time to have dinner, and then we kind of stayed afterwards just to see if she would show up because I knew it was a bar that she liked to go to, or at least that she had told me about.
Mm-hmm.
It was not called Halo's. It was called Heroes. It was called Heroes, not Halo's. So I asked, you know, bartenders, waiters, waitresses, if they had seen her, recognized her. Nobody did. I asked if I could leave, you know, some flyers there in case she should show up. We went to the house that she lived at, when we got there was a couple people there. It was a younger guy and a younger girl, and then another man. Carson's car was in the yard, but they said Carson was not there. One of these people was a roommate. The other two, I guess, were some friends, the younger guy and girl. They were some friends. But they said that Carson had gone out to lunch with his brother. His brother had come into town, and they were out having lunch. And they didn't know when he would be back. He did get back while I was still there. I wasn't really allowed to go through the house. I was allowed to step in, but that's as far as I could go. So most of the time that I was there was spent outside in the yard talking to these people. The younger people said that they knew her. They had, you know, hung out with her. They all worked at the same place. The other guy, he worked at the same place with them. He said he didn't know much about Jessica or Carson, and he lived in the home too. Didn't know much about them. They kind of just kept to themselves, but had no idea what had happened to her and couldn't tell me anything about it or the day that she left. Carson got there. I asked him what was going on.
Well, that's so. Well, no, said, we can't just fluff. We can't fluff over that just so easily. You're there.
Okay.
He comes back. Would you say that he was surprised to see you? I mean, what was his reaction when he saw you in the yard when he and his brother pulled back in?
I couldn't tell by looking at him what his reaction was, but it was really nonchalant. He walked over. Oh, hey, Ashley. You know, just like he was still the neighbor that lived next door, and we were just seeing each other going to the mailbox or something. It was very, like I said, nonchalant. It was just like a normal day. And so his brother never did get out of the car. His brother just left. So he asked, you know, if I was there to talk to Jessica. You know, of course, she didn't live there anymore. He said that he didn't know where she had went.
So he takes you inside, and didn't you ask him if she left any clothes? Did she leave anything behind? And what does he do?
I did. I asked him if she had left anything, and he said, yes, I'll be right back. And he takes off, and I'm just standing kind of at the doorway in the kitchen, and he walks through the house, and he comes back, and he's carrying her suitcase, this big, ginormous suitcase. And I said, oh, she left us? And he said, yeah. So I grab it. It's extremely light. You know, there's obviously nothing in there. So I open it up, and it is a pair of shorts and a shirt. And that's all that's in there. That's all that was in that suitcase. So I asked him, I said, if she left her suitcase, what did she pack her things in? Because this would hold all of her things. Did she pack them in grocery bags? And he said that he did not know. And so I said, well, what about her dog? Because she has a dog also. What about her dog? He said, well, I'm going to assume that she took her dog with her. And she didn't take her suitcase.
And once again, he's claiming that she just took off in the middle of the night, somewhere around the 22nd, 23rd of January, which would have been several weeks before that, before we were there.
Right.
Just took off in the middle of the night.
Well, that's what he said. He said that, which his story to me was a little different than the one he told to the police. He said he didn't know what was going on with her, didn't know why she left. He told me that he had let her borrow some money, and it was coming time for her to pay. And I guess and this is what he said, I guess to keep from having to pay me back, she just left.
Mm-hmm.
Which is very strange. This is the guy that gave her credit cards and said, spend what you want. This is the guy that was paying for half of the bill.
Right.
You know, same guy that she moved here with. So
right.
That did not make any sense to me.
Of course not. Okay, so you're there. He gives you the suitcase with the two pieces of clothing. He's giving you this story that I'm not sure many people are going to believe, but that's the story he's telling. It sounds like a little bit different story than he told the police. He left out the money issue, I guess, when he told the police, but you weren't there. Who knows what exactly he said to the police? So, but you did mention that he has these roommates there, and we're going to just name their names, if that's okay with you.
Yeah.
Okay. Laverne Knox, and Laverne is a guy. And we're still not sure if his name is Jesse or Jeff Palmer. I'm just going to call him Jesse to make this easy. Those were the two guys there. You got to talk to both of them?
Yes.
And would what did they say? And would you say that their stories were consistent?
At the time, I guess I could believe that maybe they wouldn't know much or didn't know much. Yeah, I mean, she hadn't lived there that long. And honestly, like, how good of a relationship could they have established? And I don't know, you know.
Well, I'm just, Ashley, I'm just asking you, when you talked to them, what did they say?
Oh, okay. That they weren't really sure what happened, that she was there and then she wasn't, and Carson said that she had left, and that's pretty much all they knew. They didn't know much about her or where she went, just that Carson said she had moved out, and that was it.
Okay. Did you say that Laverne and Jesse and Carson were all in the same business?
Yes, they all worked for the TPI company.
Do you think that Carson was actually working for that company, or do you think that he was mainly just doing his drug running or whatever he was doing while he was in Tennessee?
I think that he was, because actually Laverne had told me that Carson was planning on leaving the house because he was going to quit the job and he didn't want to work there anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I assume what he was telling me was truthful, because he also worked at this company too, but he said that Carson just didn't want to work there anymore, and he was going to be moving out next week.
Okay.
So.
All right. Did you have any idea? So, was it your impression, once again, thinking back, I know it's been some years now, that Carson was in that place on Old Grantham Road first, and Laverne and Jesse moved in with him, or did they get that place altogether? Any ideas?
I don't know. I can't say who would have been there first.
Okay.
I feel like that was something that Jessica came into after maybe they were already there, but I can't say for sure because I don't know.
Okay. But they left you the impression, we don't know if this is true or not, but Laverne, once again, he's a guy, and Jesse gave you the impression that they really did not really know Jessica hardly at all. She was there, but she was with Carson most of the time, and then she was gone, and that's about all they knew about her.
Yes.
Okay. But did you also tell me, and once again, this is my notes, and we'll just straighten this out now, did Jesse, though, maybe give you the impression that he and Jessica might have been a couple or something?
He did. He said that they had gone out a few times. Not that they were actually boyfriend and girlfriend, but that they had gone out a few times. They just didn't get along very well. Not together. So they just kind of decided that they would not go out anymore.
Okay.
And so I said, oh, okay, you know, because, you know, if you don't get along with somebody, you don't go along
right.
with somebody, so that's fine.
All right, so I guess what I'm saying is, on one hand, they gave the impression they didn't know her very well, but on the other hand, Jesse's saying that he and Jessica went out alone a couple times.
I don't know if they went out alone or not.
Okay.
He didn't specify that.
Okay.
So, I mean, they very well could have, or they could have went out with friends. But I do know that they had gone out a few times.
Okay.
Just don't know how personal it was.
All right. And the listeners should know that we do know where Laverne Knox is. We had to, between Ashley and myself, we had to first get the age right. We were a little off on that to start. We'll just leave it at that. But being that he has such a unique name, we were able to see where he is now. But Jesse Palmer, we're still unsure. Of course, Jesse Palmer, or his name might have been Jeff Palmer. Still not sure who he is, very common name. But how old would you say? Was he a white guy? Was he Hispanic, black? What was he, as you remember it?
Jesse?
Yes.
Yeah, he was white.
White guy? Okay. Yeah. And what age would you say he was approximately when you saw him in early 2012?
I thought he was kind of young, late 20s, early 30s, maybe okay. mid 30s. That's the assumption I got. He did not appear very old to me.
Okay. And your understanding is both Laverne and Jesse were in the welding or something like that business at the time?
Yes.
Okay. And like I said, I'm sure some of the listeners maybe will look up Laverne Knox, but he is out there, and we'll just leave it at that. Okay. So these are the roommates. We'll come back to them in a moment. Let's move on to this. Jessica's phone info. She did have a phone. She told you she was about out of minutes. Did you ever get any phone information for her, any ping information? Have the police ever told you anything about her info? And then we'll talk about Carson's info.
Regarding her phone, they said that when they did get her phone record, they said that on January 21st, that was Saturday, she had made phone calls, incoming calls, text messages. She was very active on her phone. Her phone was pinging off towers close to where she lived in Goldsboro. They said Sunday, January 22nd, her phone, she had incoming calls and incoming text messages, but none of them were ever answered, and there were no outgoing calls or text messages. Again, the phone was still in Goldsboro. It never left, her phone never left Goldsboro.
Okay.
It stayed there.
Okay.
Now, shortly after that, of course, it did deactivate, the phone did.
Okay. And what about Carson's phone info? Do you know anything about his info? If you can say.
His phone information was in Goldsboro a couple days after I talked to my sister. His phone takes off to South Carolina. It's gone for about 2 or 3 days, and then it comes back to Goldsboro.
Okay.
So he did travel. That's where my sister's phone did not travel.
Okay. How do you know about Carson's phone info? How did you get that information?
We have an investigator that's been working on the case, a state investigator.
Okay.
And he wanted to verify, because this is a very odd piece of information. Jessica was drawing food stamps at the time, and her food stamp card was being used at the same location where his cell phone was pinging off those towers.
Oh, really?
So while he was pinging in South Carolina, her food stamp card was being used in South Carolina, and of course along the way back to Goldsboro. So her food stamp card made the trip. Her phone did not.
Huh. And so you can infer either Jessica's with him and just left her phone in North Carolina when they went to South Carolina, and she's using the card, or the phone, or she stayed there, and maybe he or somebody else was using her card.
Possibly.
Okay. And do you know how long this food stamp use or EBT card, whatever it was, lasted after he came back from South Carolina?
I believe it was until the middle of February, or might have been the end of February, because it seemed like it stopped being used after an investigation started to open up.
Yeah, once you had gone over there and found out he was over there.
Yes.
Being that you went over there in February. Okay. And we also have to remember something else. You mentioned his brother, the two were again. We have to remember that his brother was taking part in the scam that they had in Tennessee as well. Right?
Yes.
So we have this phone info. The phone seemingly never leaves North Carolina, but her card does. And does South Carolina have any significance for Carson?
It does. Carson is born and raised in Charleston, South Carolina,
okay.
which is where he went.
Okay.
During that time, that's where he grew up. So, and we all knew that.
Okay.
So yeah, that's pretty significant.
Sure. Okay. Now you mentioned that Jessica had a dog. The dog is also still missing?
Yes.
Okay. Do you know if the dog was ever chipped or anything like that? You know, of course, depending on the kind of dog, it's been so many years. I don't know if it would still be alive given its age. But do you know if the dog might have been chipped in case somebody could scan it to make sure who owned it? Don't they do that with dogs these days?
They do, but I do not think Jessica, she didn't have it done while she was here in Tennessee.
Okay.
And as far as I know, it had never been done.
Okay. What kind of dog is it?
A Chihuahua.
Oh, a little Chihuahua. Okay. And the dog's name?
Bonnie.
Bonnie the Chihuahua.
Her name's Bonnie.
Okay.
Yep.
All right, so let's move on to this. Now, several months later, I have it in my notes as 7 months, but whatever it was, 6 or 8 months, somewhere in there, the police actually talked to those roommates that you met in February. What do you know about what these two roommates, Laverne, once again a guy, and Jesse, said to the police?
They were questioned. Their story had changed quite a bit.
Mm.
They said that, of course, they still did not know where Jessica was, but they did say that Jessica and Carson had left together, and a couple of days later, Carson came back alone, and Jessica wasn't with him anymore, and they had never seen her again after that.
And that would certainly go in line with the records that you got. Your investigator got that Carson did go to South Carolina and then came back. That seems to go in line with what these two roommates told the police months later, although they did not tell you that when you confronted them in February.
No.
Okay. Did these two roommates, once again, if the police told you, did the roommates, were they suspicious of this? Did they ever ask Carson, what happened? Where did Jessica go? Did they ever say anything about that in these questioning that the police did with them?
No, because they told the police that Jessica and Carson mainly stayed to themselves. If they were at the house, they stayed in the bedroom and just kind of kept to themselves. Jessica was a little more social than Carson was.
Mm-hmm.
But they kind of just hung out together, and so they didn't know if this was something uncommon for him to just drop her off or her to leave and go, you know, maybe back home or they didn't question it.
Did they say anything about Carson? Did Carson ever bring up Jessica after she allegedly left?
No, just that she wasn't going to live there anymore.
Okay. All right. So he tells you one thing. We have to remember this. When you went and talked to him in February, he said that she left in the middle of the night. Then months later, the roommates tell the police, no, they left together. And when Carson came back a few days later, Jessica didn't come back with him. And then you have proof that shows that he did leave for a few days going to South Carolina. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Let's move on to this. Now, how long did Carson, he ended up moving from North Carolina as well. Do you know anything about this? Did the police ever track him down for the crimes he committed in Tennessee?
They did. Got him in Kentucky. As far as from what I understand, he was in Louisville, Kentucky, And the Secret Service was actually after him. They were able to get him. He was brought in for questioning by the state investigator on Jessica's case to try to see if they could get any information about Jessica from him. And he said he had nothing to say. There was nothing to talk about. And he would not speak to the investigator about anything.
About anything regarding Jessica's disappearance?
Regarding Jessica, yes.
Okay. It is now, of course, 2020. Did he ever spend any time in jail for what he did in Tennessee?
He did. I think it was a few months. I think most of his sentence was on house arrest. And then he was, of course, on parole. But he did spend some time in prison. But then he was released on house arrest. He stayed in Louisville, Kentucky, from what I understand.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was doing his parole there. Now, we did try to reach out to him ourselves once he was paroled. The investigator on Jessica's case was able to reach out to his parole officer and ask permission if we could write letters to him. And so she agreed. To the circumstances where we could write letters, but she had to read them before she could give them to him because we were to mail the letters to her because, you know, of course we can't have his address or anything like that, or they can't give it to us.
Okay.
So we did write letters and they were sent over to her. She did give him the letters and he wrote a letter back responding that he had talked to his lawyer and his lawyer advised him not to say anything, not to answer any questions or respond to the letters. And that's the last we've heard from him.
When was the last time you tried to talk to Carson Cameron?
That would have been, I want to say, it's been gone 8 years. I'm going to say about 4, maybe 5 years ago when I wrote that letter.
Okay. I guess I'm left with the impression then, of course, Jessica told you that he had been trafficking in drugs. That's allegedly why they went to New York City. Is it then your understanding that he was in jail for these other crimes with Home Depot, et cetera, but there weren't any drug crimes that he ever paid any price for, if they even existed? Is that your understanding?
From what I understand, no, I don't know any of his criminal background, anything like that.
I understand.
For the charges that I knew about, no, I do not think there were any drug-related charges with those.
Okay. Even though Jessica told you that the reason they went to New York City was for a drug run of some type.
Yes.
All right. That when they went up there, that's what he was doing. Okay. Just have some, and of course, as far as you know today, July 2020, he is out of jail. I actually know where he is. We're not going to get into that, but I know where he's living now, and I've told you that, but I'm not going to say it here. Is it your understanding he is out of jail now?
Yes.
Okay. I just have some questions for you. Jessica did have friends in North Carolina besides Carson. You think it's weird that nobody ever called you when they couldn't reach her for a couple days, being that they were probably seeing her more, you know, more, of course, than you ever could? Any coworkers or new friends that they didn't call you? Have you thought about that?
I have. And I thought it was weird, but maybe they weren't sure how to get a hold of me. Maybe they didn't know my name or my phone number, or maybe a way to reach out. At that time, social media was just kind of taking off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, I don't even think I had a social media until 2011, maybe even 2012. But So, I mean, that wasn't really a big communication thing like it is now, back then. So, and I don't even know if these, I know that Jessica was not very, she didn't use her social media a lot either. So I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
Is it weird? Yes and no.
All right. And it very well may be that she might have talked about you, but that doesn't mean they know your phone number, right?
Right. I mean, and the same goes for them. I mean, a lot of the people that she would talk about, they weren't significant to me at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So, right. You know, when she was talking about this person or that person, yeah, I listened, but I didn't retain everything she told me because it didn't mean anything to me at the time. So, I mean, and that could have very well been the same thing for these people, too.
Right. Okay. Have you had a chance to talk to any of those people who, of course, you do not suspect in her disappearance, who knew her? Have you ever talked to any of those people from North Carolina at all?
I have not.
No?
No.
Okay. I know that maybe some of the listeners are going to be thinking about this, and it's a fact it's a topic that you and I have discussed before doing this interview. We have to think back to that guy who allegedly overdosed way back in what would have been 2010 in Carson's place there in Tennessee. Do you think that that might have played a factor in Jessica's disappearance as well?
It very well could have.
Very, his statement, remembering his statement, you know, if this ever happens again, right? That statement.
Yeah. And that could be something, you know, because how bad would it look that it happened twice?
Right.
And so, I mean, I have thought about that, that could be something that happened.
And because it happened once before, once again, Carson had already made the statement right to your face that should this happen again, he's just not going to tell anybody about it.
Nobody would ever know.
Nobody would ever know. Okay.
That's what he said.
That's what his words, not your words, not my words, not Jessica's words, not your other sister's words. Those are his words.
Those were his words. That's exactly what he, I mean, me and Jessica were sitting right there when he said it. And we were just floored. We were like, whoa,
okay.
Who says that?
Do you know of any, being that they had phone information for, or they have it still probably, being that they have phone information for Carson, do you know if any searches for Jessica have ever been done anywhere in South Carolina?
To my knowledge, no, they have not been done in South Carolina.
Okay.
I was told that there was a search that happened in North Carolina around the Goldsboro area. I do not know when that happened. I was not aware of it apparently until after it happened, but not in South Carolina, no.
Okay. Let's move on to this, Ashley. I'm sure it's been very difficult all these years, but can you tell the listeners what it's been like?
Oh, gosh. Terrible. It's not been easy. Some days it's hard to hold out hope, and some days the best way I can describe it is sometimes you want to know and sometimes you don't. I guess it really just depends on the day. Mm. You know, I've lost a sister, my mom lost a daughter, my kids have lost their aunt. You know, you think about it every single day of your life. There's certain things, I don't know.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, I know, you know, of course, I ask this to every guest, of course, if it's a family member. I've had some bloggers on here. Of course, then that question isn't relevant. But for, of course, family members, I want to always give them a chance to express their emotions about, you know, what's it been like dealing with this, whether it's a disappearance that's fairly new that we do from, like, 2018 or something a little older like Jessica's. That's why I'm asking you. And do you think that it's a little bit different being that, you know, that you're a sibling, a sister, instead of a mother? Do you think you handle your emotions maybe a little bit different than your parents do?
I think so. I think I can keep it composed a little bit better than my parents, and mostly because maybe I have to be stronger for them, you know, because it's not my child, and I don't know what it is like to lose a child. My mom has a hard time just even talking about it, and I couldn't imagine.
Yeah. Right. Right. Do you think back to that video that Carson showed you? That was the beginning of something. I mean, now it's been 10 years, but you now look at that, and that was certainly the big turning point in Jessica's life, that night that he videotaped her.
Yeah, that's a huge event.
Yeah.
I think that started everything, a dependency, not only for a drug, but a person, you know, a supplier, if you will. That's a major turn point, and I think so.
Okay. Knowing your sister like you did, are you surprised that she did that? Of course, we know that there are a lot of people who just try anything. A lot of people do drugs for different reasons, as people do everything for different reasons. Does it surprise you that she did it? Whether, of course, she might have been forced to do it, but is it a surprise to this day?
For that very moment, yes. I just would have never imagined. I mean, we're talking about a girl who got out and socialized and liked to have a good time and, you know, loved being around people to that. I mean, I don't think anybody necessarily chooses that, and maybe, you know, maybe it was just the excitement of being in New York. She thought, well, I could just do it this one time, and one time turned into one more time, and
right.
Just one more time, and then it became just a need rather than a want. I don't know. I've never suffered with addiction. I don't know.
Yeah. Right. You know, before she knew it, she was losing her job. She's losing her car. You know, and then you two aren't living together anymore, and then she's sneaking off to North Carolina to live with the guy who got her into the drugs in the first place.
Yep.
Oh. Okay. Do you have a Facebook page or anything set up for Jessica, Ashley?
One of my mom's friends has set one up for us. Several years back, it's called Find Jessica Garino, and that's the name of that Facebook page.
Okay.
Find Jessica Garino.
All right. Are you an administrator on there? Is this friend of the family an administrator? Who runs it?
My mom's friend actually runs it.
Okay.
And she has been running it.
Okay.
And then, of course, you know, Jessica had her own Facebook too, which a lot of people seem to visit that more so than the Facebook page to help find her.
Okay. So Jessica's regular Facebook page is still on Facebook all these years later?
It is, yeah.
Okay.
I guess because so many people are actively posting, I don't know how Facebook works, and the investigator said that they would not ask to have it removed, you know, for the sake of anything. You know, it could.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how it works.
Right.
But
okay.
Yes, you can still go to her page.
Okay, it still exists, even though she has been missing for over 8 years. Okay, that's totally fine. I just wanted to make sure that's clear. But you're right. I thought that sometimes if some profiles haven't been used in a while that they do delete them, but maybe Facebook knows that she's a missing person, so that may be the reason they keep it up. Okay. Any last words before we complete this interview, Ashley?
Yes. Yes. If you know anything, see anything, hear anything, let anybody know. The smallest detail, and that's not even with just my sister. That's everybody.
Right, of course.
You know,
sure.
That's everybody.
Sure.
See something, say something.
Okay. Maybe I should have asked you this. Being that you've been living with this for over 8 years, you and Jessica and your sister were friends with, of course, Carson for a couple years before she went to live with him and she disappeared. During the last 8 years, have you ever run into anybody else who ran into Carson or any stories getting back to you about maybe him being friends with other young women who maybe not disappeared, but maybe he got them into drugs or something like that? Anything like that, or does it seem to you that Jessica is the only one?
I haven't heard anything about other girls. I knew of a girl that would come by sometimes when he was our neighbor. She was younger than me.
Hmm.
Not really sure what her relationship was with him. She didn't come over often, but she would come over and hang out for a little while. So I don't know if,
okay.
Kind of strange that she was also a very young girl coming over to see this older man. They didn't seem like they had an intimate relationship because sometimes she brought her boyfriend with her. So,
okay. Because these guys who do this, kind of get involved with, and we know there are people who are in marriages who have big age differences, but a guy like this sounds like a predator to me. Usually has done this many times. And so that's why I was asking that. Maybe as we continue, of course, this episode's going to be coming out July 10th. Maybe it will come out once it gets out there that maybe some other young women have had run-ins with him as well. Maybe similar circumstances, just can't say. But I just want to thank you for being on this episode of Unfound, Ashley.
Well, thank you for having me.
You're welcome.
And that was my interview with Ashley Hartman, sister of Jessica Garino. I thank her for joining me and all of you on the program. Something Ashley and I didn't cover in the interview was something that is currently written about Jessica's disappearance on the Charley Project. Jessica's write-up isn't that long there, but this is part of it. Garino was last seen at the Carolina Treatment Center, an outpatient drug treatment center in the 1700 block of East Ash Street in Goldsboro, North Carolina, on January 23rd, 2012. Off air, I asked Ashley about this. She says that information is incorrect. Instead, Ashley says Jessica had an appointment at the treatment center on the 23rd, but didn't show up. What I think this does is even more narrows down the timeline to January 22nd, 2012. And if you'll remember, this is the date when Jessica's phone went silent. Yes, many calls and texts were coming in, but nothing was going out. This is also the date when Carson, according to his own phone records, made the trip to South Carolina. So what assessments can we make of the disappearance of Jessica Garino? It's clear that Laverne and Jesse, at the time in February 2012, were running interference for Carson in regards to Jessica's disappearance when Ashley talked to them. Why? There could be several different reasons. What's most important is that they changed their stories later when the police talked to them. What did they both say? Carson and Jessica left for a few days, but only Carson came back. And the story they told later falls in line with what we know about Carson's phone records. So I believe Laverne and Jesse's second story. Jessica disappeared while with Carson somewhere. Where do we go from there? Well, we can't forget that Carson shot up Jessica in New York City. Don't take it from me. That's what Carson told Ashley when they got back from that trip. And then Ashley saw a video of Jessica while she was high. And we also can't forget what happened to Carson's roommate in Tennessee. In fact, maybe that guy's overdose should be reinvestigated. And on that point, and this is the final one, what did Carson tell both Jessica and Ashley after his roommate overdosed? That if it ever happened again, Carson wouldn't tell anyone. That doesn't just make Carson a bad neighbor and bad roommate. It makes Carson Cameron a horrible person. I'll leave the rest of the theorizing up to you. And that's the program. If you found it informative, please go to the app that you use to listen to Unfound and give this podcast a nice review. I thank you for listening. I'm Ed Densel, and you've been listening to Unfound.